The Senate will come to order. I ask everyone present to please rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In the absence of clergy, let us bow our heads in a moment of silent reflection or prayer. Reading of the journal.
In Senate Friday, February 5th, 2021, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Thursday, February 4th, 2021, was read and approved. On motion, the Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions, messages from the Assembly, messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports from state officers, motions and resolutions. Senator Janaris.
Can we proceed to the reading of the calendar, Mr. President?
The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 68, Assembly number 957 by Assemblymember Galef, an act to amend chapter 598 of the laws of 1938.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act to take effect on the same date and in the same manner as the chapter of the laws of 2020.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed. Senator Janaris.
Mr. President, thank you for indulging my delay. That was Senator Reckl Norwich's first bill, so please congratulate him.
Congratulations, Senator Reckl Norwich, on your first bill. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 72, Assembly number 1250 by Assemblymember Gunther, an act to direct the Commissioner of Mental Health to create a work group and report regarding frontline worker trauma.
Lay it aside.
Calendar number 80, Senate print 1309 by Senator Breslin, an act to amend the real property tax law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the same date and in the same manner as the chapters of law of 2020.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Ryan to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. Changes to 485 were a long time in coming in New York State. It was a program originally designed to incentivize landlords and developers to redo old buildings in New York State. But boy, did it fall far from its original purpose. We've had scandals in Albany. We've had scandals in Syracuse, scandals in Buffalo, people building buildings with a vending machine in the basement and saying that is a mixed-use building. We've had people building office buildings with a bathroom in the laundry area to say that makes it a mixed-use residential building. So we did some good work last year. This year, this is a bill to do chapter amendments on that. But the 485A program, as it's been changed, is going to get back to its original purpose of rehabilitating old buildings. And that's what we need in our aging cities. You can couple that with your historic tax credits, and we're going to move our downtowns forward. So I thank you for the opportunity to explain my vote, Mr. President, and I vote in the affirmative.
Senator Ryan, to be recorded in the affirmative, announce the results.
In relation to calendar 80, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Akshar, Borrello, Boyle, Gallivan, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Martucci, Matera, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Palumbo, Rath, Ritchie, Serino, Tedisco, and White. Ayes 44, nays 19.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 112, Senate print 1353 by Senator Kavanaugh, an act to amend the public housing law.
Lay it aside temporarily.
Calendar number 122, Senate print 590 by Senator Benjamin, an act to amend the alcoholic beverage control law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 122, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Martucci and Senator Skoufis, ayes 61, nays 2.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 124, Senate print 112 by Senator Kaplan, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 90th day that shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Reichlin Mellon to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. Housing discrimination has a long and terrible history in this country. For more than half of the 20th century, housing discrimination was legal. Restrictive covenants made whole neighborhoods off limits to Black or Hispanic or Jewish buyers and other groups. Redlining was official government policy, and it made it difficult or impossible for Black buyers to get mortgages. Suburban developments like Levittown prevented Black Americans, including veterans, from buying homes. And when all this failed, efforts to desegregate were often met with violent racial attacks. The Civil Rights Act and the Fair Housing Act ended much of this discrimination, but patterns of residential housing segregation have persisted. Newsday's reporting in 2019 showed this wasn't accidental. Over a three-year period, Newsday conducted a detailed experiment to assess discrimination in the real estate industry on Long Island, using so-called paired testers, where two individuals with similar finances but of different races attempted to buy a house from a real estate agent. Newsday found discrimination against Asian buyers in 19% of cases, against Hispanic buyers in 39% of cases, and against Black buyers in 49% of cases. While white buyers were steered to communities that were overwhelmingly white, the minority buyers were shown houses in neighborhoods that already had higher concentrations of Black, Hispanic, or Asian residents. And in other cases, agents required documents and imposed conditions on Black, Hispanic, and Asian buyers they did not impose on white buyers. In the aggregate, these actions showed and they clearly perpetuated patterns of racial segregation. So following Newsday's report, the Senate took action with an investigation conducted by three Senate committees and a report outlining findings and recommendations. Now today we're passing a number of bills that came out of this investigation, and I'm proud to be supporting them. I just want to note that this bill is particularly important because it requires the Attorney General to conduct annual covert fair housing testing to assess compliance with fair housing laws throughout the state, essentially taking Newsday's groundbreaking investigation statewide and making it an ongoing feature of state law. These investigations will surely uncover additional discrimination, but perhaps most importantly, the knowledge that undercover investigations are being conducted may have a significant deterrent impact on real estate agents who might be tempted to discriminate. Passing this package will move New York along the path of progress towards our goal, where society is free of housing discrimination. I'm proud to vote yes.
Senator Reichland Melnick to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Aye, 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 130, Senate Print 715 by Senator Thomas, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Ryan to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to explain my vote. The Division of Human Rights was established in New York State with all good intentions to provide a streamlined mechanism to resolve cases of housing discrimination. But there was a big loophole built into the penalty phase of this, and it limited what judges could do if they found out that somebody had discriminated. And you often had cases where somebody would be found to have discriminated, but there was zero damages and zero penalties available. Here's why, Mr. President. Damages were only assessed if, in fact, the person who was the victim of discrimination couldn't find an apartment right away, had to go to a homeless shelter. But in upstate cities where there's a relatively soft market, you could be discriminated against in the morning and get an apartment in the afternoon. And that would lead to a judge finding that the landlord discriminated, but there's zero damages and zero penalty. This bill fixes this. And this bill fixes this by allowing the judge, even if there's no other damages, to put a penalty, a straight penalty of $25,000 against somebody who discriminates for their first time, up to $75,000 for repeat offenders. This will send a message to the landlord community throughout New York State that we do not tolerate housing discrimination, and it'll give us the opportunity to continue to strive to uphold the promise of the Fair Housing Act of 1968. So I thank Senator Thomas for his hard work on this issue and in identifying this way to close the loophole. And Mr. President, I cast my vote in the affirmative.
Senator Ryan, to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 130, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Akshar, Borrello, Gallivan, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Rath, and Steck, I-51, nays 12.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 225, Senate Print 538B by Senator Kaplan, an act to amend the real property law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 180th day after shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannoris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Kaplan to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to start by thanking my majority colleagues for their partnership and investigation and hearings that brought us here today. I'd also like to thank Newsday for sparking the flame with their Long Island Divided investigation series that uncovered the widespread problem of minority homebuyers being treated unequally on Long Island. And most importantly, I'd like to thank our majority leader, Andrea Stewart Cousins, for ensuring that this majority always stand up for what's right and advance a just agenda that supports all New Yorkers. There's no dispute the fact that we have a problem on Long Island when it comes to unequal treatment of minority home buyers. And we also know that it is not a victimless crime or offense. So it demands our action and attention. Fixing this problem going forward and ensuring everyone is treated fairly is going to rely on better education and training for real estate professionals, as well as stronger enforcement to deter bad actors from engaging in harmful, illegal tactics. I'm proud to sponsor legislation today as a part of the Senate majority's effort to ensure all homeowners are treated equally, to ensure that all real estate brokers and salespeople undergo implicit bias education, and to set up a strong covert fair housing testing program to ensure industry's compliance with fair housing laws. This package of legislation is an important step forward, but by no means is the end to our mission to ensure equal treatment for all New Yorkers looking to start a family and live their American dream. It is a task that will require every one of us to continue to be vigilant and to continue to speak out when we see injustice taking place in our community. And with that, I proudly vote aye, Mr. President.
Senator Kaplan should be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 225, vote in the negative, Senator Lanza. Ayes 62, nays 1.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 226, Senate Print 945B by Senator Gorin, an act to amend the real property law and the state finance law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 60th day after shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannoris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Gorin to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. Newsday's important investigation revealed what so many of us already knew. Racial discrimination and segregation continue to persist on Long Island. That's why it's so important for us as legislators to address this. Last year, we took a very important first step, and we passed legislation that I sponsored that will now revoke the license of a real estate broker or salesperson if they violate our human rights laws. We continue to hold hearings to deliberate, and I want to thank Leader Stewart Cousins for making all of this happen and moving this along. And you know, we are in a pandemic. We're dealing with very difficult health issues, economic issues, but you know, in the state legislature, we can deal with other issues as well. And that's why I am so proud of this package and also the legislation that I am sponsoring today, which will create an anti-discrimination in housing fund. This will help to bring us to a more equitable society here in New York, and it will make sure that it doesn't matter. You are entitled to the American dream, whether it's on Long Island or anywhere in this state, regardless of your race, religion, national origin, skin color, creed, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, age, military status, sex, marital status, or disability. I vote in the affirmative, Mr. President. Thank you.
Senator Gorin to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 226, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Gallivan, Oberacker, and O'Mara. Ayes 60, nays 3.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 227, Senate print 1448 by Senator Hoylman, an act to amend the real property law.
Lay it aside.
Calendar number 229, Senate print 2131A by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the real property law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannoris, Krueger, Ortt, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 229, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Griffo, Lanza, Oberacker, and Tedisco. Ayes 59, nays 4.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 230, Senate print 2132B by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the real property law.
Read the last section.
Section 5, this act shall take effect on the 1st of July.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannoris, Krueger, Ortt, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 230, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Borrello, Helming, Lanza, Oberacker, and Rath. Ayes 58, nays 5.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 231, Senate print 2133A by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the real property law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannoris, Krueger, Ortt, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Serino to explain her vote.
Since taking office, I have not supported bills that would increase or implement new fees. I have a personal conflict with this bill in particular, and as such, I've asked to be excused from voting on it.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Announce the results. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 231, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Addabbo, Akshar, Borrello, Gallivan, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Martucci, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ortt, Palumbo, Ritchie, Steck, Tedisco, and White. Ayes 45, nays 17. Senator Serino excused.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 232, Senate print 2157A by Senator Thomas, an act to amend the real property law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannoris, Krueger, Ortt, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Thomas to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I also want to thank the leader for pushing forward this package on housing discrimination, because this should not be happening in our communities again. In 2019, Newsday published a three-year investigation of discrimination by real estate agents, revealing evidence of widespread, separate, and unequal treatment of minority potential home buyers and minority communities on Long Island. Additionally, the investigation revealed that Long Island's dominant residential brokering firms appear to be helping to solidify racial separations. In response, the New York State Senate conducted three separate hearings after subpoenas were served on agents and brokers. The testimony revealed several issues, including lack of supervision and lack of deterrence, among other issues. In order to rectify the lack of deterrence, I introduced S-715, which passed this House a few minutes ago, designed to deter violations of human rights law in relation to fair housing discrimination. Fines are increased to $25,000 for the first offense, $50,000 for the second, and $75,000 for the third. And in order to rectify the lack of supervision, I introduced this current bill, S-2157A, to hold office managers to the same standard as licensed real estate brokers. For many Americans, owning a home is a step towards obtaining their American dream. The purchase of a home is a huge financial decision for potential buyers, and the real estate industry should be acting ethically. These two bills, along with those filed by my colleagues, are going to make sure this does not happen again. Discrimination has no place in our communities. I vote in the affirmative. Thank you.
Senator Thomas to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to count of 232, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Gallivan, Griffo, Lanza, Oberacker, O'Mara, Rath, and Tedisco, ayes 56, nays 7.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 233, Senate print 2525A by Senator Kavanaugh, an act to amend the real property law.
Lay it aside. Senator Janaris, that completes the reading of today's calendar.
Mr. President, can we go back to calendar 112, remove the temporary lay aside and take that bill up, please?
The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 112, Senate print 1353 by Senator Kavanaugh, an act to amend the public housing law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Kavanaugh to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President, and distinguished colleagues, both here in the chamber and participating in today's proceedings remotely. I rise to explain my vote on Senate Bill 1353, which has established an obligation to affirmatively further fair housing among state agencies and those receiving state housing funds. As you know, Mr. President, this bill, along with the entire legislative package that we're taking up today, seeks to put an end to widespread discriminatory practices that were detailed first by an extraordinary expose published by Newsday on Long Island, and subsequently detailed in a lengthy report on fair housing that was recently issued by Senators Skoufis and Thomas and myself and the Committees on Housing Construction and Community Development, Investigations and Government Operations, and Consumer Protection. The report and much of today's package is based on testimony from stakeholders at the two Senate hearings, document requests, of course, Newsday's findings, and various policy meetings and research conducted by members of the committee and the committee staff. This bill intends to address housing discrimination as it manifests itself across the state, not just in the home sale market, which was the focus on Newsday, but the broad range of we see discrimination. It seeks to amend the public housing law in relation to establishing that requirement of a further affirmatively furthering fair housing. Mr. President, that means going beyond merely refraining from discrimination or enforcing minimal standards. It requires that housing agencies and other state agencies, anybody involved in the housing space, and any locality receiving housing money of any kind from the state, to take meaningful steps to further our goal of fair housing by identifying and overcoming patterns of segregation, eradicating racially and ethnically concentrated areas of poverty, and reducing disparities in opportunity, and eliminating disproportionate needs for housing that are being unmet. The purpose of the bill and the entire legislative package to provide transparency and accountability in the housing industry for the benefit of all New Yorkers. Now, I would note that this is not a new idea. The Fair Housing Act at the federal level in 1968 required a statutory requirement that all federal recipients of money affirmatively further fair housing. There was an attempt early on to implement that, but it largely went dormant for many years until the Obama administration in 2015 put forth a set of regulations that were intended to implement it. Unfortunately, the Trump administration effectively suspended those regulations and made it such that that obligation is no longer in effect at the moment for much of the country. The report we put out urges the Biden administration to reinstate that at the federal level, but in the meantime, it's a great step forward to be reinstating at the state level. I'd like to again thank our leader, Senator Skoufis and Thomas, who co-chaired the hearings, and all of our colleagues that participated in this process. It's my hope that our legislation, including this bill and the others in the package, will usher in a new era of equality and justice for home buyers and renters throughout the state. And with that, Mr. President, I vote aye.
Senator Kavanaugh, to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Jackson, to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. My colleagues, I rise this afternoon in order to support this bill that was just introduced and explained by Senator Kavanaugh. Housing is a human right, and housing discrimination denies people that right. And it is evident that fair housing advances economic opportunities and help close the wealth gap that has historically disadvantaged communities of color for generations. Our communities of color are still reeling from the devastating effects of decades-long discriminatory practices, including redlining and disinvestment in communities. As a legislator, I know, as an African-American black man, 26 years old, was discriminated, in my opinion, when I was looking for an apartment in Washington House, where I currently live. When I went and asked for an application because I saw all of these windows vacant on the third floor. And the super said, I'm sorry, we have somebody, we gave an application already. So when we give out an application, we don't give out any more. I said, well, how do you know that they will qualify, this, that, and the other? The bottom line, I left without an application. I found out where the managing agent office was, and I went out there. And at the time, I was working for the state of New York. I know I didn't show my badge. I may have given them my business card, which said, State of New York Department of Labor Special Agent. Well, I got an application. And they said, you know that you would have to produce your W-2s. And I said, no problem. You know you would have to produce your wife's W-2. No problem. Within a week, I had the apartment. Now, did I go into court? I didn't have to go into court. But I do know that approximately a year or two later, that a black couple went up to Riverdale to look for an apartment, and they saw it, and they said, I'm sorry, it has already been taken. And they felt that they were getting shafted, being discriminated against, and they went to the Fair Housing, and Fair Housing people sent a white couple up there with the same basic educational level and same income. And no problem, they got the apartment. Well, it was in the New York Times about the discriminatory practices. So as a legislator, I am actively seeking to create more diverse, inclusive communities where, whether it's upstate in Hudson Valley or Long Island or in New York City, we are working together in this chamber to overcome historic segregation patterns and eradicate racially and ethnically concentrated poverty areas. This legislation paves the way for our state agencies to affirmatively further fair housing is their mission moving forward. Strengthening the state's role in this matter will help us combat the systemic challenges like those that cropped up on Long Island in recent years and the one that I described, which happened a long time ago. It would also help us achieve a generally fair housing and prevent discrimination in public and private housing, protecting tenants and buyers alike. My thanks to Senator Kavanaugh for drafting this bill and to other drafters of the bill in this package for your work in advancing fair housing framework that moves us towards justice. I proudly, Mr. President, vote aye.
Senator Jackson, to be recorded in the affirmative, announce the results.
Aye, 63.
The bill is passed. Senator Janaris.
Mr. President, can we take up the controversial calendar now?
The Secretary will ring the bell. The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 72, Assembly number 1250 by Assemblymember Gunther, an act to direct the Commissioner of Mental Health to create a work group and report regarding frontline worker trauma.
Senator Lanza, why do you rise?
Mr. President, I believe there's an amendment at the desk. I ask that we waive the reading of that amendment and recognize Senator Jordan to be heard.
Thank you, Senator Lanza. Upon review of the amendment, in accordance with Rule 6, Section 4B, I rule it non-germane and out of order at this time.
Mr. President, accordingly, I appeal the ruling of the chair and ask that Senator Jordan be recognized.
The appeal has been made and recognized, and Senator Jordan may be heard.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to appeal the ruling of the chair. The proposed amendment is germane to the bill at hand because the bill at hand deals specifically with the trauma that frontline workers experience. As we have maneuvered through COVID-19, our frontline workers have had countless executive orders implemented by Governor Cuomo. There has been a lack of clarity and order with these numerous orders, and now we are hearing about one of the latest directives. The amendment I put forth on behalf of our conference would finally restore checks and balances of our state government and see the state legislature become a co-equal branch of government once again. This will be the 12th time that we find ourselves in a position to reassert ourselves and reestablish the necessary separation of powers so vital to our democracy. The case has been made by my Senate Republican colleagues and me all year, even stemming back to last May, when we first forced a vote on this motion. New Yorkers have endured the arbitrary economics restrictions, the fumbled vaccine rollout, and the disastrous and deadly nursing home scandal. Fast forward to today, Governor Cuomo and his administration are still neck deep in these controversies. In fact, these things have gotten worse. And what has the state done to restore the necessary checks and balances? We've heard threat after threat, but that's all it's been so far. All talk and no action. On vaccines, finally, we saw the governor last week, without any advance notice, add new eligibility for New Yorkers with comorbidities. My colleagues and I love the idea, but we wish we could see more collaboration between the executive and local governments in vaccinating more New Yorkers. Keep in mind that our county governments have been ready, willing, and able to administer mass vaccine in instances such as this pandemic. In terms of economic restrictions imposed by the governor, to give an example that hits close to home in my 43rd Senate district, does it make any sense why bowling alleys are open, yet so many billiard halls remain closed? They operate in much the same way. Bowling alleys have reserved lanes, billiard halls reserved tables, both clean equipment used between reserved groups. Both can provide social distancing while playing the game. The governor refuses to explain his arbitrary edicts unless he finds time in one of his press briefings where reporters aren't even given adequate time to ask important questions. But this is what happens when you put one person in charge and when one person overstays his time. The governor is not a king. One person rule is antithetical to democracy. Another thing that happens when one person is put in charge, that person starts to mistakenly believe he's unaccountable to anyone but himself. We all saw the AG's bombshell report on nursing homes. We've seen the mass exodus of health department officials. And I'm sure you've seen our conference's calls for an independent investigation, calls that have been ongoing for months. This issue is a stain on the governor and a disgrace to the entire state. The administration needs to stop its stonewalling. And that's why I'm urging the Senate majority to stop turning a blind eye to his administration's failings today. Again, today will mark the 12th time we vote on this common sense, good government amendment. 10 times since the beginning of this year. But forget the past. Stand with us today. We know for a fact that some of you want to, so do it. Stand with us now. This issue is bigger than partisan politics. It's about doing what's right and the state legislature reasserting its rightful prerogative as a co-equal branch of our state government. Nothing is stopping our colleagues from voting on this amendment today, at least nothing we know about publicly. We all know it's the right thing to do. For these reasons, Mr. President, I strongly urge you to reconsider your ruling.
Thank you, Senator Jordan. I want to remind the House of the voters on the procedures of the House and the ruling of the chair. Those in favor of overruling the chair signify by saying aye.
We've agreed to waive the showing of hands and record each member of the minority in the affirmative.
Without objection, so ordered, announce the results.
Ayes 20.
The ruling of the chair stands, and the bill in chief is before the House. Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. The secretary will ring the bell. Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the same date and in the same manner as the chapters of laws of 2020.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Brooke, to explain her vote.
Good afternoon, everyone. we're living through unprecedented times right now, and this piece of legislation will provide much-needed research on the adverse effects of COVID-19 on the essential frontline workers who have tirelessly supported New Yorkers throughout this pandemic. Just last week, I hosted a virtual town hall on the mental health needs of essential workers in the 55th District in Rochester. And we heard from more than 100 of our community's healthcare providers, teachers, laborers, and small business owners who are struggling with not just their physical health, but also their mental health as they keep our communities running. They shared stories of juggling childcare at home, work outside of the home, and worrying about keeping their families safe and cared for while they care for us. Workers told of the mental stress of working long days under impossible conditions, with little time to rest, reflect, or recover. But anecdotal evidence is not enough. We need this task force to study and report out on the adverse impacts that COVID-19 is having on our frontline workers. And even more crucially, our government and our service providers need these recommendations to effectively meet those workers' mental health needs. I'm proud to support this bill today to ensure that our essential workers are heard, understood, and acknowledged, and that they get the care they need after they have cared for us so well during this pandemic. Thank you.
Senator Brooke, to be recorded in the affirmative, announce the results.
Aye, 63.
The bill is passed. Senator Giannaris.
Senator Summer Brooks' first bill.
Congratulations to Senator Brooke on your first bill. The secretary will read.
Calendar number 227, Senate Print 1448 by Senator Hoylman, an act to amend the real property law.
Will the sponsor yield for some questions?
Standing in for the sponsor. I'm happy to yield.
Senator yields.
I didn't realize it was going to be you. This is going to be a tougher one now. Mr. President, I'd like to ask a question. I believe it seems to me that this is a solution in search of a problem. I've done hundreds and hundreds of closings, and I've never seen this issue of a signature. So this bill would require the Secretary of State of New York to promulgate rules requiring real estate brokers and salespersons to legibly write his or her name and license number in any document requiring a signature. It's my understanding that the New York State Department of State has not received a single complaint of a consumer being unable to identify a real estate salesperson or broker. My question to you, Senator, is do you have any examples of members of the public who have been harmed or fraudulently mistreated by a real estate professional who has been seeking the signature that haven't been able to find them?
Yeah, through you, Mr. President. This bill originated with some concerns that were raised in Queens by former Assembly Member Michael Dendecker, who originally drafted the bill, where it appeared that someone was attempting to pass themselves off as a real estate professional licensed by the state, but was not in fact so. So the idea of this bill is, the initial idea of this bill was simply that there be a clear identification. We issue brokers and salespeople a number. They are required by law already to carry a card that has identifying information, but the public is generally unaware of that. This bill, as my colleague has noted, only applies when the licensed professional is required to sign the document, and it simply requires that they identify themselves clearly with a printed name and this number that's already been issued to them.
On the bill.
Senator Boyle, on the bill.
As the senator said, this is already done, basically. The real estate professionals are required to carry a card, clearly mentions their name and real estate number. There are identifying features. Are there some bad apples? Probably, but there are ways to do this without making it law that they legibly write their name and number. I would just say that there's a good number of these bills. I commend Newsday for the investigation, and I think that part of the answer is training. Some of these bills do that. I think it's great. I would say that when this training classes do take place, they should include one of the most important things. None of us want to see discrimination in real estate. Just make it illegal or prohibit real estate professionals from answering any questions about school districts. When I read that the articles in Newsday and I attended the hearings down on Long Island, the vast majority of these realtors are honest, not racist, not bigots, good people. I know personally a couple of them that were involved in the articles. They just simply answered questions about the school districts, which were problematic. We don't have any discrimination, and this bill is not the answer, so I'll vote in the negative on this. Thank you, Mr. President.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. The secretary will ring the bell. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ork, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 227, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Addabbo, Axar, Borello, Boyle, Cooney, Gallivan, Gorin, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Martucci, Matera, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Palumbo, Rath, Reichlin, Melnick, Ritchie, Serino, Scoofus, Steck, Tedisco, and White, ayes 38, nays 25.
The bill is passed. The secretary will read.
Calendar number 233, Senate Print 2525A by Senator Kavanaugh, an act to amend the real property law.
Senator Martucci.
Thank you, Mr. President. Through you, will the sponsor yield for a question?
The senator yield.
Happily to do so, Mr. President. Happy to be back feeling more myself now.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. This bill requires every real estate broker and every real estate agent to collect demographic data on every real estate transaction. And we're talking about properties listed or shown, the location of such properties, the disposition of every offer received, and whether or not a closing occurred. How is the Department of State equipped in terms of funding, staffing, and overall capability to handle the expansive amount of data that will be sent in from the state's approximately 50,000 real estate agents and brokers?
Through you, Mr. President, as has been noted, this legislation will require licensed brokers and salespersons to request a voluntary disclosure of various demographic data that all relates to protected characteristics under current law, and to retain such data and to provide a report to the Secretary of State. I would note that this bill comes out of recommendations from Professors Max Baberus of the University of Wisconsin and Jacob Faber of NYU, and also Fred Freiberg, who is of the Fair Housing Justice Center, all of whom were very instrumental in the committee's work on the package that we're seeing today. But my colleague is misunderstanding the aspect of the bill that requires data to be reported to the Secretary of State. The bill requires the details of this to be retained for 2 years by the broker or the salesperson, but it only requires that a summary of that data be provided annually to the Secretary of State in a form that the Secretary of State would provide.
Mr. President, well, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
This bill memo indicates that there will be a cost to the state to implement the bill. Does the bill include any appropriation to cover the cost?
Through you, Mr. President, we don't believe that there would be a substantial cost to this bill. There are other bills in this package that expand the funding available for fair housing work, and we think this is very much a part of that. But on the other hand, we're in the midst of a budget process, and the executive agencies are certainly free if they think that this is more than the usual cost that might be added by a routine incremental change in their very substantial regulatory responsibilities. They're free to certainly request additional appropriations to that. I will notice that every single person who is required to submit this report is already paying a pretty substantial fee to be licensed by the state, and this should be a very minimal cost of the overall cost of regulating those sales professionals.
On the bill, Mr. President.
Senator Martucci on the bill.
I want to begin by thanking my colleague, Senator Kavanaugh, for answering my questions and addressing my questions today. What we have here, I believe, is a very well-meaning piece of legislation, but like much of what goes on here in this chamber and in Albany in general, it's being passed without knowing what the real cost to taxpayers will be and where the money will come from to successfully implement the suggested program. This is exactly the kind of thing that the folks in my district are so frustrated with. This bill and others that we're considering here today assumes bad intent on the part of nearly 50,000 real estate agents operating in our state and places additional burdens on all of them for the alleged past sins of just a few. Because this bill has a fiscal impact but provides no funding, and because it does not demonstrate that the Department of State can effectively handle these new responsibilities, I'm forced to oppose this legislation. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Palumbo.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the sponsor yield for questions, please?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Senator Kavanaugh. Just by way of clarification, on page one, lines 10, 11, 12, 13 there, generally, if the client refuses to give the information or gives an incomplete answer, would the broker be in compliance with their duties under this proposed legislation? And would the sponsor yield for another question, please?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr.
Sponsor
President.
Yields.
Thank you, Senator. And if they are non-compliant, could you please describe what the sanction would be for that willful or an even negligent non-compliance? And that's kind of two questions in one, if you don't mind breaking that up, or if you'd like me to, I certainly will.
Through you, Mr. President, I assume that my colleague's question refers to if the broker or the salesperson were not complying with this new requirement. The Secretary of State has broad authority to oversee this industry and the licensed professionals under it, and this violating this rule, like violating many other rules, might result in a decision by the Secretary of State to take enforcement action, but there's no specific penalty associated with this particular collection of data requirement that this bill would impose.
Thank you, Senator. And would you yield for one more question, please, through you, Mr. President?
Does the sponsor yield? Sponsor yields.
And thank you, Senator. And I see here there's kind of a catch-all section, 442E of the real property law on violations, that it would ultimately be that the Attorney General would prosecute it, but the penalty would ultimately be a misdemeanor. In the first few lines of it, misdemeanors, tribal, in a court of special sessions, any person who violates any provision of this article shall be guilty of a misdemeanor, of a crime, and by reference, that, of course, would now include this new section 442M. So my question to you is, in light of the fact that your proposed legislation is silent, it's ultimately a crime for noncompliance, just so I can be clear, if a broker does not comply with this newly proposed legislation that's before us here today.
Thank you, Mr. President. Would my colleague mind, since the provision he's citing is not in the bill before us, if it could repeat the section of law that he's referring to, just so we can take a look?
It's 442E, and this is a proposed section in Section 1. The proposed bill is 442M, so it's earlier in that title. It just says violations, Section 1, misdemeanors, tribal in a court of special sessions. Any person who violates any provision of this article shall be guilty of a misdemeanor. And I can read further if you'd like. The commission of a single act prohibited by this article shall constitute a violation thereof, all courts of special sessions within their respective territorial jurisdictions are hereby empowered to hear, try, and determine such crimes without indictment and to impose the punishments prescribed by law therefore. So actually, now that I read all the way through, that's somewhat inconsistent in its own language. But it would at least be a violation, in the way that I read this, that any violation of the overall article would ultimately be a misdemeanor. And that's where I'm looking for some clarification, if you don't mind, Senator, through the President.
So you know, just wanted to consult with counsel since, again, that provision is not before us in this bill. But just generally, just to respond, first of all, generally, there are a variety of provisions in the real property law, and that provision that you're speaking of seems to have been on the books for a while. And yet it does not, we did discuss this bill at some length with representatives of the industry, including the realtors themselves, as well as others in the real estate industry. The objections we've gotten to date have not been about subjecting anybody to a misdemeanor, but more the kind of, you know, the complexity of the administrative burden of complying with this and how it might affect their interactions with customers. Having said that, you know, you raise an important point. We will take a look at it. It is not our intent to create a misdemeanor out of a minor violation of the law. Perhaps if somebody were willfully and consistently refusing to comply with a law like this, maybe it would be elevated to that. But you know, you raised the point, and we will take a look at it and certainly ensure that we have a clear understanding of that before it is signed into law.
Terrific. Thank you, Senator. On the bill, Mr. President, please.
Senator Palumbo, on the bill.
Thank you. And Senator Kavanaugh, I certainly do appreciate that clarification, and I do appreciate the fact that you're going to certainly take a look at that, because obviously this is very important data that we need to compile. As stated by some of my colleagues on this floor, that investigation revealed some atrocities that we all are offended by, and we need to make sure we get to the bottom of it, and I get it, and ensure this is absolutely the appropriate and laudable intent. But unfortunately, with, I think, generally that article is not the best drafted article in the real property law that I've seen. We have a lot of issues with it, I think, generally, that kind of overlap. But as a catch-all provision, that's a concern. That I don't think the failure to just collect information that I would suggest is a little bit sensitive to get from someone, to ask them in your first interaction with them, you want to be a client, I now would like to know all of this personal information, including ethnicity, origin, ethnic origin, those sort of things, gender, how you're identifying. I think that this may open up a can of worms, but we need to get to that result in a reasonable fashion, and I think we're all in agreement with that. I would just ask that we certainly take a further review on the language of this bill, because I think that the unintended consequence will be quite severe. Thank you, Mr. President.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. The secretary will ring the bell. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 90th day after it shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Kavanaugh, to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate the opportunity to explain my vote and clarify just a couple of the points that were raised by colleagues in today's debate. First of all, one of my colleagues mentioned that this is a broad response to a few wrongdoers. I just want to note that the Newsday investigation and our subsequent investigation really did demonstrate that a lot of these behaviors that a bill like this is addressed at and the other bills in the package are addressed at are really widespread. In about half of all instances where a black prospective home buyer walked into a broker's office in Long Island, they experienced discriminatory treatment. And that has been well documented now. So a bill like this that is intended to create a broad framework to understand how this process is working for all home buyers in the state is really sorely needed. The second thing I would just note, my colleague mentioned that this is sensitive information. Race and ethnicity and gender are, of course, sensitive topics for some, but it is not unusual these days for us to be asked basic demographic information to provide on a voluntary basis for the purpose of ensuring that our other entities are complying with their obligations to be fair and to treat people equally. So I would envision this being done like many other forms, where you're asked these questions, you're able to, it's clear that it's optional, you can skip them if you want to, or you can include them if you desire as a client. It should be noted that systems like this do collect a great deal of demographic data, even though they're voluntarily. And in fact, this bill is modeled on a current law, which is national, which requires every single mortgage application to include this kind of demographic data and the outcome of that application. And in that case, as my colleague noted, it would be burdensome for the administrative agency and the enforcement agency to receive all the individual transactions. With respect to mortgages, that is the law. Each client and that information is reported directly. In this case, all we're doing is having an annual summary of this data. We think this is a reasonable balancing act for a very big problem that we've seen, and we think that this will be part, along with the rest of this package, be part of our state digging our way out of what we view as a very significant problem. And with that, I'll be voting in the affirmative.
Senator Kavanaugh, to be recorded in the affirmative, announce the results.
In relation to calendar 233, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Akshar, Borello, Boyle, Gallivan, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Martucci, Matera, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Palumbo, Rath, Ritchie, Serino, Steck, Tedisco, and Wyke. Ayes 43, nays 20.
The bill is passed. Senator Janaris, that completes the reading of the controversial calendar. There is no further business at the desk.
Move to adjourn until tomorrow, Tuesday, February 9th at 3 p.m.
On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Tuesday, February 9th at 3 p.m.